Good evening, and a very warm welcome to our carol service this evening. It's wonderful to have you here with us. And you've got a treat in store, we've got a wonderful choir, we've got some readings, some carols, music, a few little interviews with some people, getting their reflections on what Christmas means for them. So it should be a special evening tonight, and there's some mulled wine and more Christmas pies after the service, if you'd like to be called. Let's pray together as we begin. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this special time of year where we remember that you were born into this world in peace, joy, hope, new life. We pray that you may come and fill our worship this evening with a sense of your Holy Spirit, your presence with us. For Jesus' sake, amen. Would you like to stand to sing together our opening carol, Once in the World, David City? And Ruben will be singing the first verse as a solo, and then the rest of us in the choir will join him in the second verse.
Of God from the first days of our disobedience to the glorious redemption brought us by this Holy Child. But first, let us pray for the needs of the world, for peace on earth and goodwill among all his people, for unity and brotherhood within the church he came to build, and especially in this area of Kensal Rise and Harleston. And because this of all things would rejoice his heart, let us remember in his name the poor and helpless, the cold, the hungry and the oppressed, the sick and those that mourn, the lonely and the unloved, the aged and the little children, and all those who know not the Lord Jesus, or who love him not, or who by sin have grieved his heart of love. Lastly, let us remember before God all those who rejoice with us, but upon another shore and in a greater light, that multitude which no man can number, whose hope was in the Word made flesh, and with whom in the Lord Jesus we are forever one. These prayers and praises let us humbly offer up to the throne of heaven in the words which Jesus Christ himself has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, Amen. Please sit for our first reading.
First reading is taken from Isaiah chapter 9, beginning at the second verse. People walking in darkness have seen a great light, and those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. You have enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoice before you as people rejoice at the harvest, as warriors rejoice when dividing the plunder. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this.
We stand, we sing together, O come all ye faithful.
Thank you. Dexter 38. In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town of Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David, a descendant of David. The virgin's name is Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings. You are highly favored. The Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words. I wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end." "How will this be, Mary?" asked the angel. "Since I am a virgin." The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born of him will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, and she who was said to be unable to conceive is in her sixth month. For no word from God will ever fail." "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May your words to me be fulfilled." Then the angel left her. This is the word of the Lord.
Well, Christmas is almost upon us, and we thought it would be great to interview a few people to hear what they are looking forward to this Christmas time and what Christmas means to them. So I think we should have Kay and Paul and Celia and Mom. If you can come and join me on the stage, we would love to interview you guys and hear a bit about what you're looking forward to this Christmas time. First of all, Celia, come on, come on, come on, I want to say two questions. Is there anything special about Christmas in their family this year? And the second thing is sort of a deeper question, and that is to do with the sort of spiritual significance of Christmas for each of these people that they're going to share this evening. So firstly, Celia, tell us a bit, what are you looking forward to in Christmas this year?
This year is going to be the first year that both sides of the family all together for Christmas. So my husband's parents and my parents and my little daughter are going to be in one house.
And what sort of spiritual significance then? What does Christmas and Christian faith sort of mean for you?
Well, Christmas for me and a lot of people is about the baby Jesus. It's about the amazing wonder and madness and beauty of the fact that God decided to become embodied and become incarnate in the shape of a tiny, vulnerable child, a baby that couldn't even speak. And the wonder, the love that he felt for us, that he allowed himself to be that vulnerable, is what I
think about. Amazing, thank you so much. Paul runs our midweek home groups and has done so for a couple of years. Paul, tell us, what's special about Christmas for you this year?
Well, Christmas is always a family occasion. This year, alternatively, it's this year we're in England. My wife is staying, so another year in Denmark, which is a bit rubbish. But we're in England this year, so it's family, it's Bristol, we're all together, and we'll be eating lots of turkey, no doubt, and we'll have lots of wine.
Yes. Very good. And on the sort of spiritual significance thing, I know you've faith is relatively recent. Can you tell us a little bit about what Christmas means to you now, and perhaps how it's changed over the years?
I think Christmas now means a new beginning. We said this morning, it struck the beginning. It's the start of a new Christmas year, Christian year. It's his birthday. It's Easter is the end. Christmas is the beginning. We start off fresh. And I'm looking forward to the beginning.
Thank you so much, Kay. I'm going to join you here. Kay is our administrator here. Kay, tell us, what are you excited about Christmas this year?
It's just the time for the band to get together and appreciate spending time with each other. It's not so much gifts in the way of presents, it's more being gifts to each other.
Amazing. And tell us a little bit for you, what spiritual significance Christmas has for you.
It's got a massive, sat down with you. It isn't. It's a time when I choose to remember what God has done in my life and the power of God. So for me, Christmas is really about the power of overcoming through Christ. So yeah, it's a time to praise Him.
Amazing. Thank you so much. Mark, tell us, what is Mark? Mark's a relative newcomer in our church. He's been to my visa, come down from Durham. They've been here for a few months now. And so, Mark, tell us, what are you looking forward to Christmas this year?
Yeah, for me, it's a chance to see family. I love the whole kind of Christmas thing. Everyone getting together. My favourite Christmas experience is when all the Button Girl clan kind of coming together. Yeah, great chance to see friends, some of whom I haven't seen since last Christmas as we head back up north to Auckland.
Amazing, lovely. And for you, on that sort of spiritual question, what sort of spiritual significance does Christmas in your faith have for you?
Well, I've grown up in a Christian family, and so Christmas has always been kind of one of those key centre points of the year that has always been a focus of reflection of life, and similar sort of characters there, that Jesus came down and lived with us, I just find stunning really, and for me that changes everything, and that changes how I see the world, who I see myself as in the world, and how I try and live.
Amazing, thank you so much. We'll give you more round of applause.
Oh.
you like to stand as we sing together on the next congregational carol, Silent Night, Holy Night.
stand as we sing together in a little town in Bethlehem. Christmas is now just around the corner. Hopefully some of us will no doubt be making different preparations for this Christmas period. I'm sure some of us have decorated our homes and got our homes beautified and ready for the Christmas season. Christmas trees and baubles and different decorations around the house. Some of us have no doubt have had office parties and trying to finish off work before the end, before Christmas itself begins. And perhaps some of us too have been preparing Christmas food, Christmas pudding perhaps, or working out whether they have turkey, goose or beef or something else this Christmas time. And perhaps some of us too getting ready to travel, either with relatives coming to stay with us or us going to stay with other friends and relatives. And finally, of course, there's presents too. No doubt some of us are going to be giving and receiving presents this year. And there's something about loving, about giving a good present, not necessarily a physical thing, but the present of being with a family member or a friend, the present of being around a table perhaps together, the present of just being in the joy and the wonder of a church beautifully lit and candlelit. I don't know about you, but I've been drawn by some of the different Christmas advertisements that there are. And a friend of mine sent me a copy of the Mulberry 2015 Christmas ad, the clothing and accessories store. And hopefully, I want to show it to you this evening. If our AV works and it's up and ready on the screen, let's take away the Mulberry ad. Hopefully, it should come up on the screen. Lonely, hungry, tired, far away from home. And when we draw a little bit closer to home, children who wrote some letters to Santa. The first one was raised to 6. He said this: "Dear Santa, 16-inch pipe, love Rupert." Another one wrote: "Dear Santa, if you bring presents, bring batteries, Derek." Another one said: "Dear Santa, it's Claire again, but I'm writing to my 9-year-old brother named Mitch. He wants to find a hole puncher. I want to find a hole puncher too, and a skateboard. But don't give the skateboard to him. Mitch is very kind-hearted, but he has a bad temper. He also writes messy and doesn't like to read. Bye, Claire." And finally this one: "Dear Santa, there are 3 boys living in my house. Jeffrey is 2, David is 4, and Norman is 7. Jeffrey is good some of the time. David is good some of the time. And Norman is good all of the time. I am Norman." I think if Norman was being totally honest with himself, and he also recognised, perhaps a little bit like he saw in his siblings, that honestly, we're good some of the time. And sometimes there are things in our lives that aren't quite right, aren't quite true, that don't quite work out, some brokenness. And something in us cries out, is there more? Is there something that won't be broken? Something that will satisfy? Something that will meet some of our deepest longings? And of course, the message of Christmas is that a gift that doesn't break, a gift that gets better as we grow to know this gift, has been born into this world. The gift of God Himself in human flesh, a little baby, Jesus. Someone once said, our greatest need can be for information. God would have sent us an educator. If our greatest need can be technology, God would have sent us a technician. If our greatest need had been money, God would have sent us an economist. If our greatest need had been pleasure, God would have sent us an entertainer. But our greatest need was for forgiveness. So God sent us a saviour. Because of course this child didn't remain a child. This child grew up, became a man, walked on this earth, showing us how to live, to display kindness and love for others. Welcoming others in, lifting up the downtrodden, humbling those who needed humbling, and ultimately went to the cross for you and me, so that we could be forgiven for all the stuff in our lives, to be made right with God, a new relationship, a fresh start, a new beginning. I was chatting with my soon-to-be 4-year-old daughter earlier in the week, and we were chatting about the differences between Santa and Jesus. And she said to me, she said, "Daddy, of course, Santa is only there once a year. Jesus is there all the year in your heart." And that's true. I came across a little sort of poem that says this: Santa lives at the North Pole, Jesus is everywhere. Santa comes once a year, Jesus is always here. Santa fills your stockings with goodies, Jesus supplies all your needs. Santa comes down the chimney uninvited, Jesus stands at the door of our hearts and knocks politely. Santa makes us wait in a queue, Jesus is right there when we call. Santa lets us sit on his lap, Jesus lets us rest in his arms. Santa has to ask our name, Jesus knew our name even before we did. Santa has a belly like a bowl full of jelly, Jesus has a heart full of love, grace and mercy. Santa says, ho, ho, ho. Jesus says, cast your cares on me, for I care for you. Santa's little helpers make toys. Jesus mends weak hearts and repairs broken lives. Santa makes you chuckle. Jesus gives you joy. Santa puts gifts under the tree. Jesus became the greatest gift by dying on a tree. And for some of us this evening, like those people who spoke earlier in the evening, we'll be looking forward to Christmas, not only to celebrate with free time with family and friends and enjoy good food and maybe open a present or two, but also to give thanks to God for being born in human flesh so that we could know Him, know His peace. But then also, no doubt, one or two of us perhaps here this evening are not quite so sure. Perhaps you can relate to something of the loneliness, maybe some of the darkness, some of the fear, some of the uncertainty, some of the brokenness that life seems to throw up
tentatively open up the sort of stable doors of our heart and say, Lord, would you come and be born with me tonight? It might not be very attractive in there, but Jesus is used to being born in places that others might not want to be. Ready and willing to come and be born in your heart and my heart afresh this Christmas time. May you pray. Let's have a moment of silence just to allow the Spirit of God to grow in each of our hearts this evening. Some of us with hearts of thankfulness. Some of us with hearts of sadness this year. Others with hearts of uncertainty. I'm going to say a little prayer that you can echo if you'd like to in the silence of your heart. It's a simple prayer inviting Jesus to be born either for the first time or afresh in your heart this year, to bring peace and joy and hope, his life, even in the midst of situations of darkness. Here's the prayer, just echo it if you'd like to after me in the silence of your heart. Dear Lord Jesus, thank you that you came down from heaven to be born as a baby, that you grew and became a man to show us how to live, and went to a cross to die for us, so that we could be forgiven and set free and made right with our Heavenly Father. We come to you now this evening and ask you to come and be born in our hearts afresh this night, to fill us with your joy, your peace, and your hope, for your name's sake. Amen. And a prayer for anyone who prayed that prayer this evening for us all. Dear Lord, we pray as we head into Christmas 2015, you may fill our hearts and our homes with your light, your peace, your wonder, and your joy. For Jesus' sake. Amen. And we are Jay is going to come and sing for us.
those whose journey is perilous but necessary in order to flee the conflict, those whose journey is required in order to seek work, those whose journey is vital to fetch water and to gather food. Lord, will you bring them the precious gift of hope? Father, as we remember that the inns were full with the holy family turned away, we pray for those whom the world forgets or chooses not to see. Those in refugee camps, hospitals, or those without a safe place to sleep on the streets. We lift up to you those who lack the help that they need to get by. Those who grieve whilst others rejoice, and those who are miserable and without friends. Lord, will you bring these, your children, your precious gift of joy? Abba, as we remember the celebrating shepherds and the singing of the angels, we pray for those who need to hear your message of hope. Those whose livelihoods are threatened by climate change. Those who have missed out on the chance of education. Or those who can find no employment. Those who live with illness or in difficult circumstances, such as homes where violence is present. Lord, bring these, your people, the precious gift of your peace. Papa, as we remember your son's birth in a stable, we pray for those who embody your love, who shine light in the darkness, for those in all the services who put their lives above those of others, for those who volunteer to help their communities, for those who give, who campaign, and who pray for change. Lord, bring to all the precious gift of your love. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Would you like to stand as we sing together our final carol, Hark the Herald Angels Sing?
Thank you.
come to the end of our service this evening. Do please stay if you'd like to for mulled wine and mince pies in the hall, and there's tea and coffee and some soft drinks there as well. A huge thanks to Rachel Bedford, our alderman, who's overseeing the choir this year. Let's give her a huge round of applause. May the humility of the shepherds, the wisdom of the wise men, the wonder of Mary and Joseph, and the joy of the Christ child fill your hearts and your homes this Christmas time. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit rest upon you, all of whom